Hope all the sessions during the seminar were meaningful, eventful, useful, and has contributed in providing insights about the undergraduate education in our country. So with this note, let us begin the session. I request Ms. Babita, treasurer of CES, to welcome and introduce the guests.
So it's been an insightful 2 days for us, a lot of deliberation, best practice sharing, experience sharing, and many good ideas coming our way. Thank you so much for your enthusiasm and overwhelming participation. As we get to the end of the 2 days, it's my privilege and pleasure to invite our dignitaries for the valedictory function. Please join me in welcoming Shri S.V. Ranganath, retired IAS Vice Chairman, Karnataka State Higher Education Council. Shri S.V. Ranganath belongs to the IAS Service Karnataka 75 CADA. He has worked as a civil servant in various capacities, both in Government of India and Government of Karnataka. He was the Chairman of Indian Coffee Board, Resident Director, Indian Investment Center, Abu Dhabi, Principal Secretary to various Chief Ministers of Karnataka, additionally Secretary and Financial Advisor in the Department of Space, Member Finance to the Space Commission, Atomic Energy Commission, and Earth Commission. He retired in October 2013 as Chief Secretary, Government of Karnataka. Currently, he is the Vice Chairman, Karnataka State Higher Education Council, and Member, Karnataka Knowledge Commission. Welcome you, sir. Dr. Venugopal K.R., Vice Chancellor of Bangalore University. Dr. Venugopal has been in Bangalore University for the last 4 decades. Principal, University Visveshwaraya College of Engineering, Bangalore University. Special Officer, Government of Karnataka, Dean, Faculty of Engineering. Professor Venugopal is a recipient of over 75 awards and has been conferred the prestigious IEEE Fellow Award and ACM Distinguished Educator Award from the United States of America. Welcome you, sir. Over to you, Gauri.
Hearty welcome to all the delegates and distinguished guests here, and welcome to Babita also. Thank you, madam. Now I request S.V. Ranganath ji to give valedictory address. Sir, please.
Professor Venugopal, Professor Sridhar, distinguished guests, participants, invitees for this very important seminar, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real challenge. It's a real, I feel very honored and privileged to share the dais in front of this very distinguished audience. In this audience, I can spot at least about 50 people who would be somewhere in the top 100 in who's who in the field of higher education in Karnataka. Now, that is saying quite something if one, accepts the fact that Karnataka is probably, Bangalore is probably the knowledge capital of India. So to be getting an opportunity to talk to, people who will rank in the top 50 people in the state is an honor and privilege. In addition, I am told by Professor Sridhar that we are having another 50 to 60 people who have come from outside. Very distinguished people. I was just talking to a distinguished professor from Ashoka University. He was in Stanford and he has written a book, and probably he has spent a good part of his academic life thinking about these problems, etc. My interaction with him was of 5 minutes. So to be able to get this opportunity to speak this distinguished audience, I think, is a unique honor and privilege. I also know that it is especially challenging when one is asked to participate in a valedictory function, because A, I know I stand between you and your cup of tea, and B, at the end of 2 days, you would have discussed most of these things. Now, what is it new which I am expected to say which you would not have discussed? So that is the special challenge. Having said so, I think normally in these kind of functions, I come out with controversial statements, largely because the idea is to provoke people to think and provoke them to act. And action becomes impossible if unless and until all of us contribute to action. So my first thesis before this distinguished audience is, I must congratulate CESS, Professor Sridhar and his colleagues on CESS for having this organized this seminar. They have not done it a day too soon. If you ask me what is the Achilles heel in the field of education, I will say it is the undergraduate education. My own experience states while there are loopholes in the field of up to the plus two stage, but it is better taken care of and it is probably better funded. These are issues. Now, you cannot have universities of national and international ranking unless you are able to produce people of a critical mass of above average people. My thesis before you is you cannot have quality unless you have this critical mass of quantity. So the importance of undergraduate education, according to me, is to ensure that we have this critical mass of high quality people who will later on go on to become professors and distinguished academicians, distinguished leaders in all walks of life, and contribute to not only the educational scene but to the national development. If I presume the purpose of a university is knowledge creation, knowledge dissemination, and thought leadership, these things cannot be brought about unless and until these things are, you have this unless and until you have an above average, this critical mass. This is my first proposition. My second proposition is, why is it that we say that Achilles heel in the undergraduate education? Undergraduate education, today we are at crossroads. Gross enrollment ratio-wise, probably we are around 27-28%. Karnataka may be marginally better. We are talking about a 40% gross educational ratio for the country as a whole in 10 years' time. And considering the fact that 38% of India's population is below the age of 18, the number of people who will be increasing from your 27% to 40% will probably be more than the number of people who are being sought to be educated today. You can work out the mathematics. If the system is strained to the brim, that is, there is a shortage of money, there are shortage of teachers, etc., this poses a very, very special challenge. This is problem number two. So far as the shortage of money and shortage of teachers is concerned, I have attended various seminars where people said 6% of national GDP should be invested in education, etc. There are learned debates whether it is 5% or 6%, etc., etc. But I have a sneaking suspicion. Another 50 years we'll continue to be debating on the same issue. What we have not been able to achieve in 70 years, we may not be able to do it in the next 50 years, because the kind of national priorities which need to be urgently attended to are daunting. My own feeling is there is no priority in India much more than the priority of education. This is my feeling. But not everybody shares this view. I'll tell you why I feel this. Because 21st century is the knowledge century. And if you are to focus on innovation and creativity, if India is to be a world superpower, you have to focus on innovation and creativity. And if you have to focus on innovation and creativity, you have to set your educational system okay. You have to produce world-class educational institutions. And if you have to do that, you have to improve the quality of undergraduate education in the face of problems which we are facing today. And my submission to you is we will continue to face these problems. 25 years down the line, maybe I may not be on the planet, but whosoever is in charge of CESS can look back at the proceedings of today's meeting and they will have the same problems. Shortage of teachers, then staff positions, issues of governance, etc. These are things which are not, which is easy to debate, but not easy to bring about sustainable change. It takes time, etc. So in the what really matters for us is what is it we can do in the short term, in the next 5 to 10 years, etc. Every government, elected governments across the country, you know, last 70 years have been, you know, doing their bit for the education, but it will all take time. In fact, I was telling somebody, when Professor Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar set up the CSIR laboratories in 1948, Professor A.V. Hill, who was the Joint Secretary of the Royal Society, wrote to him, if you are taking the best professors from the universities to go and work in CSIR labs, who will be there in the university to teach and to do research? So Professor Shanti Bhatnagar, Swarup Bhatnagar, wrote back saying, there are 19 universities in India, and I don't see them having much of a future. At least I am providing a platform, a pedestal where the best minds in the academic field can work together in a fearless manner without any, you know, problems to haunt them and turn out, you know, focus on knowledge creation, knowledge dissemination, etc., research, etc., which I believe is will be useful for the country and which will also help the university system. Now, there were 19 universities at that time, and Professor Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar felt this in 1951. Today, there are around 700 or 780 or thereabouts universities. The numbers keep varying, etc., because universities keep getting recognized and de-recognized thanks to court orders, etc., so that number is not static, be that as it may. This is, I'm saying all this because the numbers pose a very, very special challenge when, you know, which the administrators of the education system in India have to grapple with. If you ask me to name one single problem which the undergraduate education is being confronted with, I will say it is the problem of guest lecturers. There are large vacancies. The vacancies are not being filled up on time. Our procedures are cumbersome. It is easy to say that we should, you know, bring about changes, etc. But what we have not been able to bring about in 50 years, I doubt very much whether we will be able to bring about in 5 years. So despite all this, what is it we can do? And these guest lecturers are barely out of the universities, postgraduates. They are not permanent. They are something like kamikaze pilots in Second World War. You know, when the Japanese were losing the war, they trained Japanese pilots who were trained to take off but not to land. So the only place they can land is an American battleship or an American aircraft carrier, and they'll go and crash into this. This is something like kamikaze pilots, because these young boys and girls who are postgraduates are barely out of the universities, and they are being thrust on this undergraduate sector, and they are the beasts of burden. They are doing the bulk of this training. So unless and until you improve the quality of teaching of these people, you empower them, you enable them to perform better, you will not bring about any changes of a sustainable nature to improve the quality of undergraduate education. This is my third point. The fourth point which I would like to mention is, how is it we can do it? Fortunately, today we have, you know, we have got the benefit of technology. And it is my conviction that we are not able to fully utilize the technology. Many people tell me that technology, are you going to replace teachers? I am the first person to say no. Whatever methods you may use, etc., a teacher is a teacher, and a teacher cannot be replaced. You cannot have learning without teaching, without teachers. You take the best, you take an institute like IIIT Bangalore. Now, IIIT Bangalore is probably the best IIIT in the country. Large number of people believe that in the technical field, and I have no reason to disbelieve that. The professors of Indian Institute of Science have told me they are the best in the country, IIIT. They have taken MOOC courses from Stanford, etc. And those boys and girls are tech savvy. They can access. But each one of those students wants to have an individual sitting with their professors. When we talk about MOOC, we talk about SWAYAM, this, that, and the other. First of all, SWAYAM courses, I'm sorry to say this, my perception is SWAYAM courses are extremely boring. Now, unless you capture the attention of the person who is going through those SWAYAM courses, who will pursue this? Yes, people who are suffering from insomnia, etc., this is a painless option you can read. And what I'm saying is not a laughing matter. In fact, when I was in government, I had this problem. That is, whenever I would go on tour and forced to make an overnight halt at a place, I couldn't get sleep. This was a problem which I suffer, and I continue to suffer this problem. Until I found that, I found that when I started reading the annual administrative report of the department where I was working, that would put me to sleep in 5 minutes. This SWAYAM courses are something like that. So while SWAYAM courses are there, etc., we should look to capture the attention of people who are, because after all, there is children, what we are interested in is whether the students learn. And the students learn, they can learn by teacher-led learning, they can learn by self-learning. SWAYAM benefits self-learning. And to an extent, teacher-led learning, because the teacher's time in the classroom is spent in discussion, problem solving, and etc., which is far better way. But it's also important that there is project learning and peer group learning. You get people to work with their hands. When I talk about undergraduate education, particularly science education, this non-availability of labs, etc., bothers me very greatly. Because unless and until people work with their hands, etc., they will not be able to learn. This is, I'm convinced about it, etc. So my submission to this distinguished audience is, we should focus on setting up labs. You see, there is a lot of focus. There are programs like RUSA and Government of India initiatives. There is a disproportionate focus on brick and mortar stuff. Brick and mortar, there was learning going on in ancient India. People were sitting under a tree and learning. See, what matters for us is, are you able to ignite the passion of teachers? Are you able to ignite the passion for learning of students? And are universities being able to generate in students this love for lifelong learning? I mentioned to you about knowledge creation, knowledge dissemination, thought leadership. The fourth thing which I did not mention at that time, which I would like to mention now. So unless and until this undergraduate education improves, I do not think you will be able to bring about a critical mass of people passing out of the portals of higher education at postgraduate and doctoral and postdoctoral level, who will have, apart from these first three things, knowledge, thought leadership, knowledge creation, they will focus on inculcating a love for learning. And this love for learning can only be brought about by excellence. So with these problems, shortage of staff and archaic organizational methods, etc., how can we bring about improvement of quality of teachers, particularly teachers, your guest lecturers, or part-timers? These are all euphemisms. And this is a problem not only affecting Karnataka, throughout the country, all states without exception are being confronted with this problem. But you have got to find a solution. I should think that capacity building among teachers is a very, very important thing. capacity building among teachers is, for example, what are the outcomes, which, what are the issues which affect the learning outcomes of the students? One is the knowledge of the, there are four things I believe affects the outcomes. The first is the knowledge of the teacher. Let us presume the knowledge is satisfactory because he or she has passed out of a postgraduate, that too recently. Then there is issues of course design, course management, and how to handle the students. The course is designed after course is designed by people, experts, you know, heads of departments of various universities. Does an average undergraduate teacher understand why the course has been designed? What are the competencies which you are seeking to attain? Are children able to achieve that competencies? What is negotiable and what is non-negotiable? You have finite time. It is not like you don't have the luxury of the Socratic method. You can have 250 hours to teach a course. You have just got 100 hours or 80 hours. What is the best you can do for it? For all these things, the teacher also requires guidance. There are various things of technology you can use. Can we ensure that the lectures of the best teachers on important subjects are recorded? These are digitally distributed. This will inspire other teachers apart from helping students to learn. If you are a student of economics, and let us say for argument that Professor Jagdish Bhagwati comes and gives a series of lectures on international trade. Now you are not, you, this is something, you know, which no matter a less gifted teacher may be talking about trade for 6 months, but a few hours listening to the lecture of Professor Jagdish Bhagwati can bring about a fundamental difference. See, great professors are people who have been inspired by people, teachers who have been inspired by their teachers, of, you know, who are outstanding. I will quote to you an example. When I had the privilege of working in the Department of Space, I came across a professor called Professor Roald Sagdev. He was a Russian emigree working as a professor in the US. He had a very interesting experience. He was a person who started life as a nuclear physicist, then became a part of the Sakharov's hydrogen bomb team. Then he switched to propulsion and interplanetary probes, became the chairman of Russian Space Institute. And after Glasnost, he emigrated to US, and he's a professor at the University of Maryland working on fundamental, you know, the frontier areas of science such as dark matter, antimatter, gray matter, etc., etc. Now, he was once, I had the privilege of meeting him, and he said that his teacher, he was trained under a person called Lev Landau, a Nobel laureate. And once when he asked Professor Landau that, "You are an extraordinary person. We feel humbled just to be having this opportunity to discuss with you. I wonder who your teachers were." So the question is, he says, "My teacher, I am not even fit enough to stand before him." So when Professor Roald Sagdev persisted, his professor, Professor Lev Landau, Nobel laureate, told him, "My professor was Professor Niels Bohr. I am nothing compared to my professor." So why I'm saying this is, there is a very, very special responsibility cast on senior people. Senior people, senior professors, professors of eminence and distinction, they must mentor their junior colleagues. They will have a lifelong influence not only on their colleagues, but also on a generation of students who will evince interest and take up, you know, this issue of knowledge creation and thought leadership, which is what research is all about, etc. So, in fact, my thesis, this nobody is going to follow and nobody will follow, but my thesis will remain. Can you get the best professors to go and teach in the first year undergraduates, etc., so that the children are converted? If you ask, for example, in the University of in California Institute of Technology, I was told in the early 60s, the first year physics was taken by Professor Richard Feynman, Nobel laureate, and the first year chemistry was taken by Professor Linus Pauling, double Nobel laureate, and the first year mathematics was taken by an Adams Prize winner, the forerunner of the Fields Prize, but I forget the name, I'll recollect as I go along. Now, if those people are lecturing to you, if you are not already frightened to death, you are functioning at a level far beyond your normal self. So, can you get the best professors to come and address undergraduates? Can you lecture the best professors? For example, you see, I feel 10% of the professors are passionate. 20% of the professors are very dedicated. I'll make a difference between passionate and dedicated, because people, passionate teachers will teach as if their life depends on it. Dedicated teachers will walk the extra mile, will do everything, but I won't put them in the category of passionate. They will not inspire a generation, but they are also required. The challenge before us, can we make these passionate teachers, dedicated teachers, more number passionate? Can we make an average teacher a dedicated teacher? Can we make your immediate fresh entrants, like your part-timers, guest lecturers, euphemisms for, you know, part-timers, etc., can you make them an average teacher? They graduate up the ladder. This is the challenge where, you know, this the challenge before the university system. When you talk about improvement in quality, a newcomer, a person who has passed out of post-graduation, cannot become a passionate teacher. Passion is an outcome of a lifelong effort of initiative, hard work, with great courage, dedication, and distinction. It takes time. But can, if they graduate to the next level, that will have its impact. Can you get, for example, I find when I go to the undergraduate classes, the teacher is so preoccupied with teaching, there is no testing which takes place. Can you prepare a question bank? Can you get the best lecturers? You know, this is, after all, this is where your passionate and dedicated teachers come. They must be able to see, you must use technology to ensure that their vast experience and expertise, you know, can be utilized. They are probably today, this 30% group is shouldering 50% of the burden. Can you expect them to shoulder about 60 to 70%? Because there is no getting away from that, etc. It is these passionate teachers and dedicated teachers, their role must increase, their numbers must increase. So unless and until, so far as the other things are concerned, salaries, etc., this goes on, you know, etc. Ultimately, there is a salary structure in the country, and the teaching community is part of that salary structure. Everybody gets, etc. But I have asked so many passionate teachers, teachers of great eminence, are they working for a salary? They are not working for a salary. They work as if their life depends on it. They get joy out of it. And the job of a good teacher is to convert their colleagues into ensuring that they also get joy. Convert the students. That students are inspired. Undergraduate first year, if I had professors like Linus Pauling and Richard Feynman teaching me, etc., probably I might not even be lecturing in front of you. I might be somewhere else. But anyway, alas, I missed that opportunity. But I don't want, you know, the young people of today, they are the hope of the country. And they should be able to, you know, they should be able to get these kind of opportunities. I think, you know, I find several people looking at their watches. I am deeply conscious of the fact that at the end of 2 days, where most of these things have been debated, etc., I'm sure there would be many solutions, but ultimately, solutions are not from outside. You know, it is not a question of we versus they, it is us. See, we are the system. When you say the system, there is something horribly wrong, there is something wrong with all of us. You, me, everybody. There are people who are not participating, so we must collaborate and ensure that there is bring about sustainable change. That is the message which I would like to submit before this distinguished audience. I will again, in conclusion, I will say, what is the job of a university? The job of higher education is thought creation, thought leadership, you know, knowledge dissemination, knowledge creation, and lifelong learning. that lifelong learning is probably not stressed enough. If you, as a teachers, as the builders of the tomorrow, India of tomorrow, if you can keep this fact in mind, I have absolutely no doubt in my mind that India is well on its way to be super, to be a superpower. Being a superpower does not mean GDP, this, that, 8-9%. It does not mean how many divisions you have. I believe Stalin, during the Second World War, when he was told that the Pope exercises a lot of moral and spiritual authority, I said, how many divisions does he have? So it doesn't, it is not, you know, being a superpower depends on our ability to think afresh, to lead the world, in the field of knowledge creation. So the teachers have a preeminent role. When you talk about undergraduate education, it is teachers, it is people like you and me, ordinary people in our positions, can we do a little better than what we are doing? And I have no doubt in my mind that we can do it. Because if you think you can do it, we can do it. As they say, life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man, but he who wins is he who thinks he can. So we must all think, yes, it is possible. Can we do it? This is what I thought I will share a few impromptu ideas in front of this distinguished audience. And thank you very much for having honored me to be able to speak before this distinguished audience. Thank you.